Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes.
To everyone in the last? Fine. Let me introduce myself. My name is Sarang Bhoyar. I have been working with Infosys for the last 7 quarters, which is 18 years. But I have been counting things in quarters nowadays. That's quite a long time. So after doing typical ADM, which is application development and management, for almost 15 years, I decided to do something different because ADM is quite boring and probably will not have a future. So to save my job, I started doing some research and I found that there is something probably which will give me a better job. So I started learning about blockchain. Somebody had told me that, are you interested in working on blockchain? And I thought it is something like blog and chain. So I started Googling and I came to know it is not actually blockchain, it is blockchain. And then I actually, for the first time, I heard that word. And it sounded quite interesting because it said this is probably the next internet. So even though I did not understand the significance of it at that time, but obviously if it is the next internet, probably I'll get a better hike in the next job. So I started learning that technology. So most of the, the material that is available in the market, you can go over the internet, you can start learning things and all. So you will get some bits and pieces of it. But it's a little bit difficult to put all those pieces together and actually understand how it works. So I started doing one certification from Princeton University, which is on blockchain. I am still doing it because it involves a lot of coding and it needs to submit the code and to get the certification done. So I'm still not there. But it gave me actual, the real information of what blockchain is. And when we talk about blockchain, exactly what it is, because we have been hearing a lot of things about it. It's going to change the world. It's going to do this and that and all. But exactly what it is, what it means to you, what it means to the people who are working in IT industry, or for that matter, in other domains, and how it is going to impact you. So in this small session, I'll try to put things together. My assumption was that the attendees have some basic information about the blockchain principles, because what I am going to cover has a little bit of technical information. To understand that part, you must understand some of the basics of it. I'll try to cover those, but this time is not enough for it. So I'll try to cover some part of it, and then we'll try to relate it to the things that I'm going to talk about. And in this process, whenever you have a question, you can ask, I'll try to answer it concisely. If it cannot be taken up right now, we'll take it up during the panel discussion. So before we move ahead, some disclaimers. I'm not representing any organization here. All the views that I'm going to put here are my personal views. They're based on the experiences that I had in last more than 3 years while working on the blockchain, and also for so many years in working in the projects. Okay. So what I do in Infosys is, as I said, I moved to the blockchain work almost 3 years back. And I started working with the product arm of Infosys. So there I do program management for all the programs or all the engagement that comes to Infosys Edge work for a framework or the product that Infosys itself has developed. So there are two parts. There are people in Infosys who work on the blockchain engagements, and there is a product arm that has developed its own framework, which was initially based on Bitcoin Core, because at that time there was only Bitcoin Core, which could be called as a mature blockchain framework. There were other things also, and then over a period of time, we shifted to a framework agnostic kind of a product, which works also on Corda and Hyperledger. Okay. So part of this disclaimer, I would say that I would try to steer clear of anything that is IP of the organization. I will try to tell you some generic things. by that way we'll try to understand the blockchain and how it is, you know, how this phenomena is evolving. Some of the key assignments that I have done is I have been part of that first production implementation of blockchain in India. I can call it one of the first, people can debate, but it's all over the internet. You can see it in the news. The first remittance transaction over the internet, over the blockchain, was done between one of the leading private banks in India and one of the biggest banks in Emirates. There are a couple of more clients who have done production transactions on blockchain in the space of trade finance. Okay. So what is there in trade finance? Something like whole cycle, which you can call supply chain, right from the purchase order, invoices, invoice financing, PO financing, bill discounting, letter of credit, then B2B payments, C2C payments, and all that. So whole cycle is there, everything can be covered. So that product is built to handle all that, and it has been production tested. Okay. So let us move. I have tried to put some definition for you of a blockchain. This is the IMP question for 10 marks, so you should memorize all that. Even I don't remember what all I have written, but I would like your attention to the words that are highlighted there. So if you comprehend, if you put them together, you would understand, you will get some idea of what blockchain is. Okay, so what it is? Timestamp, immutable, blocks, chain, distributed, peer-to-peer, consensus, and finally, cryptography. You put all these things together, and you get a blockchain. Okay? So none of these things that I mentioned here are new or were new at the time when blockchain was released to the world. So cryptography was there, hashing was there, peer-to-peer network was there, everything was there. So what was new? That somebody tried to solve a very particular problem. Okay. So person or a group of persons, which we call Satoshi, tried to solve a very particular problem of how to achieve trust in a peer-to-peer network where nodes are not known to each other. Right? So he tried to solve that problem by putting together the pieces which involves the concepts of peer-to-peer, the gossip protocols, crypto, and consensus. So you put all these things together and you get a technology which solves this problem for you in the context of doing financial transactions in a trustless network. Okay. As I said, you might hear a lot of things about blockchain. It's going to change the world. It's going to do this thing for you, that thing for you. See, try to understand that this blockchain is not an acquirer that is going to dissolve all your problems. There are very specific use cases. There are very specific things that where blockchain has a relevance. Okay, if certain things are, you know, getting done in a particular way in today's environment. And it does not involve certain factors, you know, some of the factors Colonel mentioned in his presentation. So if things are working fine, blockchain is not a solution or that we should be looking at. It is something very specific which would require blockchain kind of a technology to solve that problem. I am not sure if I'm going to get there. Because my, as you see, the title of this presentation is about taking you to the selection of frameworks or talking about different frameworks. We'll see if we get a time, we'll come to that topic. Okay. So there is another, in one of the conferences, previous conferences, I talked about challenges in practical implementations of blockchain in today's world. So that presentation is available on YouTube. It's an excellent presentation for 1 hour long. A lot of doctors have recommended it to their patients who are suffering from insomnia. So you can also try that. And with the combination of these two pills, it would give even better results. So there, I had mentioned a lot of things. What are practical challenges? So first thing that there I mentioned was the selection of a framework. There are so many things here. There are so many things that are in my market. It started with Bitcoin, which is on the Bitcoin Core framework. And then a lot of people started thinking about different types of framework because they wanted to solve certain problems that are associated with the Bitcoin Core. We'll try to touch upon those problems and then we will see why certain other frameworks were in the market. Now here I cannot cover all those that are in the market, but we'll try to see some major that are there and we'll try to compare them on certain parameters. Other things that can be put as a challenges is the integration to the existing system. So there are systems for which organizations have paid millions of dollars to build those systems. They are working fine, right? There are legacy systems, there are some modern systems also, there are systems on digital platforms and all that. So why to just give it up everything for the blockchain? So blockchain is not going to be a big bang approach. Blockchain is going to go very slowly into the system or existing architecture. It is going to replace only few functions at this point. It is going to integrate with your existing systems. Over a period of time, probably you can think of as the technology matures, because there are a lot of challenges in the technology. As the technology matures and you get confidence in the blockchain technology, probably you will think of moving those functions from your core applications into the blockchain applications. A very simple example of your trade system. Your trade system, whichever product you are using right now, I'm pretty sure it's a very mature product. It offers a lot of functionalities as compared to what are offered by some of the startups or some of the even bigger organizations through their blockchain product. So you don't want to replace such a brilliant product that is already working fine with a very nascent product which might not have a whole lot of functionalities. But you still want to try the new this new future-proof technology, which is going to give an added advantage of network kind of a software, which is going to solve a lot of problems or might create a lot of problems also, we don't know. So you want to start looking at it piece by piece and start replacing it in a phased manner, okay? So that integration, how to integrate it? Because once you integrate it, you also maintain the blockchain system, you also maintain your legacy systems. It's a double cost. So how to address that challenge, right? Then there is a high initial cost. The licenses, you need to build and all that. Their privacy, people still don't understand when we say in a distributed ledger, everything gets stored everywhere. So it's like my customer's data gets stored everywhere, what he did, how much he owes and all that. So to explain them exactly what happens when everything gets stored everywhere, we need to actually have a maturity in the organization, in the SMEs and architects of that organization, so that they understand exactly what this concept of distributed ledger is. And then you try to address the concerns of privacy and data security in that context, okay? Governance model is like blockchain is a peer-to-peer system, okay? It is useful only when a lot of people come together on that network to do certain things. It is not useful for the processes that you are already having in your organization, and it doesn't require any involvement of any outside party to complete that function. For example, your management needs some kind of a report on the data that is there. Do you need any involvement from any outside party for generating that report? Blockchain is not a case for that. Blockchain is for the process that spans across probably multiple companies, different types of companies. Simple example, when a certain trade occurs, right? I am a buyer. I want to buy 1,000 televisions. So I put up a purchase order. Purchase order goes out to a whole lot of sellers. They start bidding, so they give me a quote. I evaluate all the quotes, and then I select a vendor. Then I approve that purchase order to him, and that vendor then plan to deliver the goods to me. Now for that, he might have to do a lot of things which are offline, so he'll have to place the orders so that it gets ready in the time. He has to go to talk to the logistics vendor so that it can get shipped to me. Before that, he might ask me for certain guarantee, right? He will say, out of that 1,000 TVs price, I want 200, cost of that 200 as a upfront guarantee. So who is going to pay, give me that guarantee? Probably it's going to be my bank, right? So I have to go to my bank with a lot of documentation and say, I want a letter of credit to be issued in the name of that seller so that he gets a guarantee that if I don't pay you, you will pay them. Right, that's a letter of credit. There are other instruments through which the credits are given to the corporates by the banks, right? And then this process happens, and goods get shipped. It gets received, and then the invoices are raised. Invoices are paid through bill discounting or by simple payment mechanisms. So this is whole process. How many people are involved? There are many corporates involved in it. Buyer, seller, his bank, others, parties bank, correspondent banks, negotiating bank, insurer, logistics partner. See, these are all different companies that are doing completely different types of business. But they are involved in a single process, end to end. And all these companies are having their individual systems which are working in a silo, right? So what happens that whatever they want to do, they are doing. They are doing and their systems are doing fine. But for the parties that are outside, there is not enough of information to do, to understand certain, to get the transparency or visibility into the process. For example, he has shipped, but it has not received by the other party because the data about the checkpoints of the movement of this particular shipment is residing only in the systems of the logistic partner, right? So for him it is fine, for me it is not fine because I am not sure whether it is going to arrive on time. If I get the checkpoint that has left the origin, it has moved through the customs, it has moved through the shipping services and all that, I get a feeling that yes, probably it is going to get received here in 10 days time, right? So whenever there is a business process which involves a lot of parties that are doing business on the systems which are in a siloed manner, which results into duplication of data across the systems and also the risk involved because of lack of transparency. Very, a lot of jargons put in together, but simply put, I want to put blockchain so that a lot of organizations can come together and follow a single process on a single system, which are the single source of truth for data, and get the visibility into the process so that they minimize the risk, they minimize the operational cost and efficiency. Are you with me? Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
So when we say it is going to increase the efficiency, it's going to increase the efficiency, how is something like that? This is how it is going to be achieved. Now it is on. Is it the blockchain that is going to achieve this efficiency? See, it's not the magic software. You can replace it by some other software and it will still do the things. What is the crux of the matter is that a lot of people are coming together to form a network and work on a standardized process. Whether you use blockchain for it or you build your own system, it doesn't matter. Blockchain is just a thing that happened so that you want to readily utilize it, and it gave that vision to the people that it is possible. Right? Before that, people thought it's not possible that multiple competitors are actually coming together and trying to work together. People thought it's not possible. Why would they do that? They are competitors, right? Why would people share the data with each other? Right? But with the invent of blockchain technology, there are a lot of possibilities that people want to try out, and that's why it is gaining so much momentum and people want to look at it. I wouldn't get into the rest of the problems, but the first challenge, as I said, selection of framework. Okay. So let's say your organization decided that I want to go on blockchain. The first problem is that which blockchain? There's so many blockchains, right? There was Bitcoin. And by the way, you know, when we, in this, during this discussion, we'll try to separate two things, like Bitcoin and the blockchain. So Bitcoin is one application of the blockchain technology, which is a crypto system. That's it, okay? And blockchain is a technology which has like a widespread application across different industries for solving different types of problems. It's a technology. Bitcoin is an application. And we also need to understand two types of things. One is the public network, which is cryptocurrencies, where a lot of concepts are applied to achieve that consensus in a trustless environment. But what we are working in the industry is something which is private or permission networks. So in a private and permission network, let's say all the banks in India want to come together and try to do certain things. They are not going to join as like a 256 bits address coming into the system and trying to do. No, there is going to be a proper onboarding as it happens today. There is going to be a lot of paperwork. There is going to be all legal clauses that if you behave in a fraudulent manner, what are the actual implications in a real life? Okay? So we are just providing that technological framework, but the rest of the legal framework to take care of the regulations are already there and they are offering. So always try to differentiate between these two things. And when we say data is going here and there and he will see and all that, don't worry. Even if today your data goes somewhere and it is stolen and it is sold, the same legal remedy that is available to you today would be available when the blockchain comes in. So blockchain is not going to go and catch somebody and put it into jail. It is just a technology. Rest of the things remain as is. Okay? Now, so many frameworks, they came up and people started thinking how, which one I choose. So there are some parameters that I have put down. So depending on your organization's particular need, you need to evaluate all the frameworks that are there in the market on these parameters and probably some more parameters also, and do some kind of weighted average of different things, and then you would come to a conclusion probably, you know, these two or three that I should look at and then finalize something. So a particular framework is not going to solve everybody's problem. Everything is meant for a specific problem to be solved. We'll come to it a little later. So here you can see, you know, licenses, support model, what is the roadmap, what all things are they going to build into that framework over a period of time, what are the current challenges, what is the community involvement, right? And at the bottom, a very important thing, interoperability, right? What it means that today, I go live on network which is on Coda. I start doing the production transactions. My data, production data goes into the system. Tomorrow, Coda goes off. It goes bankrupt or whatever. Some problem in the technology. Now, we all want to move to a hyperledger. Now, what happens to my production data that is on the Coda network? Would it just, can you just put it and, it's like a data migration moving from the MySQL to Oracle or Postgres? No, it is not like that. It's not a database. These are blocks that are linked together. And if you try to put in something in between or you try to take out something else, the whole chain becomes invalid, right? So something that was valid in the Coda framework is not going to be valid in the Hyperledger fabric for that much, right? So as a big organization, do you really want to get into a system which is so nascent and evolving that you are not sure whether whatever investment I have made today is going to be fruitful 2 years later? So what I want is, yes, I want to start with it, but I want some kind of assurance that if I want to move from this to another framework tomorrow, it should be possible, and that framework should provide that possibility to me. So it should be interoperable with other frameworks. Or some people try to form their network on Coda, other people try to do it on the hyperledger fabric. Some people try to do on multi-chain. Now I don't want to move away from my existing network, but I still want to do business with the people who are on the fabric, right? So it is a network of networks. So framework that you are trying to choose should be able to connect to other networks, so you form a complete big network, network of network, right? So we haven't even started. So what is blockchain? Heard a lot of things, and when I thought about it exactly, how do I put it? What is it? What is it really? So I thought of it as a bundle of services. Okay? So basically any technology that provides you these five services, you can put them together and call it as a blockchain. Okay? What are these five services? First is, are we good till now? Any questions? What I spoke till now? Okay, fine. I'll move here. First service. Actually, these are interlinked services. It's not like individual service. Okay, these are kind of interlinked services. So one is necessary to achieve the other, and group of it is achieved to. Is necessary to achieve the consensus and all that. So these are interlinked, but still you can call these as the five services, five basic services, right? So validity. Validity means what? Whenever, once you form the network, peer-to-peer network, there are different nodes, and one node injects the transaction into the network. Now each and every node in the network should be able to validate, right? So how are they going to validate? There are going to be certain rules. The rules are around, going to be around the formatting. It should have from, to, this and that currency, whatever. Some set of rules. Then it should have, it should satisfy certain other things. For example, in case of Bitcoin, when you say I am transferring 10 Bitcoins from my this account, what is the validity? That particular transaction to which I am referring to should be present in the pool of transaction, which is called unspent transaction output, UTXO. Right? One of the rules, if it is not there, the transaction is not valid. So there are going to be different types of rules based on which the framework is going to decide whether this transaction is at all valid or not. And then it will decide whether I forward it to the other. Right? Second is about the authentication. How do we authenticate? Whether it's a, okay, in a permission network, authentication is pretty simple because you are onboarding people only after doing a lot of KYCs and everything. And then you are giving a particular certificate to that party. Basically it's a node. And any communication coming only from that node to SSL or whatever protocol you have agreed is authentic one. So it is already authenticated. In terms of public networks, which is like Bitcoin, authentication comes from the asymmetric encryption, wherein you have a private key, you have a public key. So if it is properly it is given to the public key, or if I am trying to spend a particular transaction and I can prove that, you know, through SigWare, which is signature verification, this is signed by my private key, if I am able to prove that, which is again just a coding. So if it gives yes, true or false, I should be able to prove it's true. It verifies, right? So that is the authentication mechanism. Uniqueness. I'll come to other. Uniqueness is to ensure that there is no double spend. You know, a classic problem of double spend. Double spend is not a problem when you have a fiat currency, you have a cash, right? So I have a 100 rupee note, I give it to this person, can I spend it again? No, because it's gone. I cannot spend it, right? Can I take a Xerox of it and give it to the person? No, he won't accept. Not a valid transaction. So, double spend is not possible in a fiat currency. Double spend is not possible when there is a centralized agency involved, right? Like I have 1,000 rupees in my bank account. I tell my bank, pay this to Manish, to his account. Bank takes it, deducts my account with 1,000, it balances zero. Money is gone to his account. Now can I go and say, pay 1,000 to this? You'll say insufficient balance because there is a central authority be involved, in that case also double summit is not possible. But when we talk about a trustless system when there is no central authority, and we are talking about completely digital kind of asset moving from one part to another, there has to be a mechanism in which if I send it to somebody, and because there is a time lag between when I initiate a transaction and when actually a transaction is completed, there is a time lag, right? Till the block creation, blocks, number of blocks get added, and then only there is a confirmation that this transaction has happened. In the meantime, I should not be sending it to somebody else if I try to send it. The protocol should be such that it ensures that only one transaction happens. Now, I'm not saying that the first transaction would be valid or the second I send is valid. It should ensure that there is only one transaction that happens, that money gets transferred to another person only once. So either this person or that person. That is how I ensure uniqueness, so I solve the problem of double spending. Then, consensus. Consensus is a mechanism through which all the parties in the network come to a conclusion or agreement on the history of the blockchain and the current state of the blockchain. Which means all the parties, all the nodes on the blockchain agree that till date these many transactions have happened. Everybody has the same understanding of how many transactions have happened. And everybody has the same understanding of what are the current, what is the current state? You can call it as, you know, let's say how many unspent transactions are there, or which account has how many coins, or whatever, if you're talking about some other asset, right? So everybody has the same understanding. So the ledger that everybody is carrying is in a consistent state across the network, so that when a particular transaction comes in, everybody would have a same answer on whether this is valid or not, that this can be spent or not, because they have exactly the same set of data. So they agreed on a consensus, they agreed on a state, and that algorithm to achieve is called consensus mechanism. We'll come to the consensus, how consensus are achieved in a later part, right? Yeah?
In the blockchain, every
just a request, if you can stand up,
in a blockchain, every node has a copy of a record, right? As you say, you know, every record is consistent. Now what happens if suppose any record becomes inconsistent or invalid? Does the entire blockchain invalidates, or how it is taken care of?
For that I have to start from the start and come to that point, right? So yeah, so what I will do, we'll park this question. It's a very important question. Unless we achieve this part, whole blockchain is useless, right? So it's a very basic question which has to be answered, but we'll take it a little bit later, okay? If time permits, or during the panel discussion. This is again one of the basics. How do you ensure certain things that I said? One of the things is consensus. We have to discuss this in detail to understand how it works, right? And immutability, I just complete this one, okay? And immutability, you must have heard that blockchains are tamper-proof. How many of you heard this? Blockchains are tamper-proof, right? Blockchains are not tamper-proof, okay? This is a wrong terminology. Blockchains are tamper-evident,
yeah.
Okay? What it means, let's say there are these many nodes in the network, and everybody has their ledger. I have my node, I have my ledger. What I did in my ledger, somehow I made some changes. Would I be able to do that? Yes, I would be able to do that. What's the problem? Correct, I will be able to do that. Problem starts, see, I will be able to do that. Problem is, I will not be able to propagate to each and everybody and convince them that this is the right one. Even I would be able to convince some of you that this is the right one, but considering the vastness of blockchain network and anonymity involved in it, I don't even know how many people are there, how many people I have to convince. So there is a absolutely negligible chance that I would be able to convince more than 51% of people that what changes I have made to my personal blockchain are actually valid, and you should also accept that. So if I try to do that and I try to send it to you based on the rules that are already defined and the way we are working, everybody would know that this is not right, right? So I won't be able to convince anybody. So my tamper is evident to all of you. My tampering of blockchain is evident, so that it gets discarded. Once it gets discarded, it is off the chain. It's orphan, right? I was able to tamper. So it is not tamper proof, it is tamper evident, and over a period of time, I won't be able to propagate my falsehood to the whole network. That is the way we are securing the blockchain.
Sachin, but the understanding of tamper proof is that once the block is generated, it is approved by everybody, then it is tamper proof. That is what is the understanding we are having.
It's over a period of time. See, again.
It's like if the block is there on the chain,
once it is defined as a block, then it is tamper proof.
It is not tamper proof, it is very, very difficult to tamper.
Understand.
Correct. So if you are saying that, can you say it is 100%, can you say for with 100% assurance that nobody can tamper?
No, that is not the case.
Right? What I am saying, it is the possibility of the tampering getting approved by everybody in the network is so minuscule that we, for the sake of practical implementation, want to assume that it is tamper proof.
But how do we identify whether it's a tampered or not tampered? Because as you mentioned, one of the speakers, that there is a different vast service provider available, and not more than 51% is with one service provider, like no yours. For possibly there is one another vendor which I'm dealing with day in, day out. He is using some another vast service vendor, and through some network there's a duplication or syncing is happening. Due to whatever reason, if networks get disconnected, he might have a different set of data. For him it's right, for you it's a different set of truth. So who decides and who regulates, who's correct, who's not correct, and based on that, no, it will be a chaos at a later stage.
Sure. Again, two parts to the answer. One answer is for the permission pledger. The problem of inconsistent data does not occur in a permission database, right? Permission ledgers, permission blockchains, because there is a way in which a particular truth is recorded on blockchain. Agree on this one? Okay, now a lot of confusion about how it happens in a public, where you don't know people, you don't know how many people are there, you don't know how many ledgers are there and what they are writing to. Now, mechanism, actually it is again off the topic, but it has to be taken up, so I will cover. So, the inventor of blockchain utilized a very smart concept of incentive engineering. Okay? Incentive engineering to achieve honesty in the network. So generally you get incentivized when you are dishonest. Right? You do some fraud things, you take others' money and all that, then you get incentivized, right? But think from this perspective, if you find a solution wherein you get more and more incentivized if you remain honest, wouldn't you want to be honest? Right? But actually by very nature, we are not honest, right? So there has to be a mechanism through which I achieve that honesty and I get paid for it. So how did this mechanism was derived? Was through a concept of mining, right? And this is only for the public blockchain. So I have a lot of nodes, and it is open for everybody to decide whether they want to do a mining or not. Okay. So normal nodes might not be miners. We'll come to one of the slides which would give you some idea on that. Now you would be miner, which means that what is your job as a miner? You have to validate all the transactions that are coming to you. Validity, authenticity, uniqueness, all that you have to do. And very honestly, you have to put them together and create a block and then send it across. Now, obviously, a lot of people are able to do it. And how do you distribute the reward that is coming out of block? So, yeah, puzzle, a game. Whoever wins the game gets the reward. So what is the game? Solving a particular hash puzzle. What is that hash? What is hash? Do you know? How many of you do not know what is hashing? Okay, what is hashing, I tell you. So hashing is a function. It is not an encryption. Hashing is a function which can take any amount of input. Of course, binary inputs. We're talking about digital world, right? It takes any amount of input and converts them into a fixed length output. Okay? Any amount of input. It can take image file, it can take text file, it can take XML, whatever you give it to it. For it, it is just ones and zeros. It takes in ones and zeros. It has certain steps through which it reduces the size and comes to a very fixed length output, which is whatever is defined. For example, in case of SHA-256, the output would be 256 bytes. Right? So whatever you give it, it always gives you 256 bytes. Now, you must have heard that hash functions gives you a unique hash. Have you heard this?
Yes.
If you give anything to it, you get a unique hash, right? Which means if you give file A, and all of us runs that, gives that file to hash function, you will get a same output of hash, correct?
Yes.
Property of hash function. If you give file B, you get another hash, which would be different. So if hash 1 does not match hash 2, I know it is from different file. So without even seeing a file, I am able to tell that file is different. Zero proof, zero knowledge proof. What it means? Without even seeing a thing, you would be able to tell the answer to a question that I asked you. Is it a valid transaction? So without even looking at who is sending to whom, how many Bitcoin, you should be able to tell it, and this is achieved through a very clever mechanism of hashing. So if you hash a particular thing, you can tell this is the transaction that was there on the blockchain or has it been tampered. Because the hash changes drastically as soon as even the smallest thing in the transaction is changed. Again, it is a very vast topic.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that answer is not complete yet.
Yeah, sorry.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but I have a question with respect to the amount of cost involved in mining. To keep that honesty intact is really worth, that's what I wanted to understand.
Yes, yes.
Because the incentive is going down, right, for miners,
yes,
over the period of time. So it used to be like 25 bitcoins for a miner when it started. It has come to 12, it has come to even lesser now. So when you say you get an incentive to keep mining it, is it worth investing the amount of infrastructure that is required for mining? Yeah.
Not a topic that we can discuss here.
Sorry.
Right? But whether it is worth or not is a simple business problem to solve. Investment versus output. As simple as that. As a businessman, forget about blockchain. As a businessman, if you are not getting the output, forget about it. Put it somewhere in mutual fund. So it's a simple answer. It has nothing to do with the blockchain.
But you know, in the hybrid, you know, infrastructure and network, the hash generated was correct. But over the travel or transition, this hash got corrupt. How does blockchain will detect or, you know, tamper evident what you said, right?
That's why I said it is a step-by-step process through which I will have to explain. So I started with something which you, where you understood that, you know, if certain thing is hashed, it gives you a fixed length output. So.
Sorry again to interrupt you. Just a quick, just correct me if I'm wrong. What I have heard is to get back to the same hash, if you're using SHA-256, for example, to get the same hash, it takes years to get there and a lot of computation, is it so?
Correct. So there are a few basic requirements of a hash function to be very good, right? What is first property of a hash function? It should take any amount of input and translate into a fixed length of output. First property. Second, it should be impossible to convert that hash back into the original file. But you can have a hash, but you can't do anything with it. Only thing you can do is you would be able to verify if two inputs are the same. So if hash matches, two files are same. You don't know what is in that file. So isn't it a very clever way of, you know, giving people ability to verify if two things are same or not without even telling them what is in it? Isn't it?
Yeah.
That is what was thought. So, if somebody says, this is the transaction, I'm signing it, if hash of it matches the hash of what I can get out of that, I would say, okay, transaction is not, you know, nobody has did anything to that transaction. So this is on a very high level, but how do I achieve that, that, you know, incentivization? How do I achieve the honesty in the network? That was the main question, right? So I was coming to that one. And so I have miners. Miners do mining. They do validations, create a block, send it across. Now I just want to ensure that it goes, the reward goes to only one. So what I do a puzzle, whoever wins gets the reward. Here again, if you really look at the blockchain network, there is no concept of who did it first, because there is no concept of a global time. Everybody is on a different time. Again, the latency in the network is so much that if I create a block and send it to 10 people, somebody might create a block little later and can send it to 100 people. For them, that is the person who mined it first. For these 10 people, I am the person who mined it first. So really, who mined the first? So there is no concept of global time. I cannot say I mined it first. It is up to the network to decide who has the maximum number of copies of that person. So over a period of time, it would be decided who wins. So there is no concept of I actually send it, so there is nobody sitting there that yes, he sent it. So nobody is going to say that. So how it is achieved? I'll just go forward. So,
yeah.
Answer the part of the question which I said. But my question is, since you already touched upon that, the syncing problem, that time zone difference, the speed of traveling of data and other things, but over the two networks, how do you take care of, you know, the twist, that who's right, who's wrong, how do you decide that his hash is correct or my hash is correct? Because over the one network, I agree, there won't be a sync problem. But over the two networks, wherein you are not holding your data with one particular vendor or past service provider, with one vendor, so obviously you will be having a two vendor. There is a possibility of network of protocol, right?
Pass and everything. You know, you're confusing with these two things.
Okay, sorry.
We are talking about a public network. There is no bus.
Okay.
It is a peer-to-peer network. Anybody can install a software and join as a node. There's no requirement of any service provider there. What you're talking about is a permission network, and there this problem doesn't arise at all.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
So I
think
you can just let Sarang to complete his presentation first. If you have time available, I think you should move forward for a question. Otherwise, we need to break for lunch in another 10 15 minutes.
Yeah, just quick.
Like, he completes the session and then we have the questions. That will just have to be in a momentum and he can complete his part.
Yeah, I think so. Whatever he's referring, I have a question on the whatever you're just explaining on that side only. All this happens like consistency, validity, authentication and all, how does the performance of transaction happen? Because today only one system takes microseconds to do your things. Now tomorrow it's going to go to millions and millions and across the world, different timing, mining and all. So did you see the notice, like, you know, any performance issues, whatever the implementation you did for the some implementation? So did you see any difference in that, you know, one node is not responding and everybody has to wait for some seconds or...
I was expecting that question. But as we move forward, that question would be answered. That is not a question. As I said, there are problems that are there in the public blockchain, which people try to get understood in the context of private blockchains. These problems are actually not present there. We'll come to it because we need to understand the differences in the different frameworks and different types of networks. Then these questions will be answered, I hope. Okay? So we'll just move forward. So these five things, anybody who provides this, immutability is something again. It is tampered, evident, over a period of time you can call it tamper proof. So what happens is that once something is written on the blockchain, you won't be able to change it. With the current set of hardwares and hashing powers to have, you have, it might take a hell lot of time for somebody to actually change all his own hashes in the blockchain and then go to each and every node and change all their blockchains. And he has to do that within the creation of the next block. Because if I take, in case of Bitcoin, take more than 10 minutes, block creation time is 10 minutes, if I am not able to change at least 51% of the blockchain in the world with whole hashing power I have, next block will be there, it will be added to all other people, and whatever I have done probably might not be useful. I have to do whole computation all over again. So I have to finish my robbery within that 10 minutes time, Italian job. Right? It's very difficult. And if I really have that kind of hashing power, that kind of hardware, why wouldn't I just go and mine it and earn the rewards? Second problem, somebody asked this question, is it really worth doing mining? Now that question is relevant to this, is it really worth even hacking the blockchain? Because let's say today I arranged for a whole lot of hardware and I have full proof plan and I started hacking everything, right? So I went into 60% of the blockchains, I changed it. So whoever, let's say Satoshi had some, he already has a lot of bitcoins. So I transferred all those to my name. Now all the blockchains in the world say Satoshi has transferred all the bitcoins to Sarang. Am I rich? Stupid. Tomorrow, as soon as they come to know that blockchain is hacked, bitcoin is hacked, the $2,000 bitcoin will be $20, probably $2. Right? So all the money that I have spent for hacking is actually worthless now. Because I have a lot of bitcoins which are not even worth $100. So this is a clever mechanism which goes hand in hand. If network is honest, if network is secure, people have more trust. The trust is built, the value of the crypto that is running the network goes up. If the value of the crypto goes up, there is more interest by the miners and the network to keep it up. So they're even more honest and the cycle continues. If it breaks somewhere, everything in the network breaks down. Right? So very, very clever thinking by a person to achieve this honesty in this dishonest world using some coding and a very clever incentive engineering. Right? The problem of decentralized trust is solved using whole pieces put together. I hope you got some concept of what this thing is. Now we need to move away from this one. This payment and everything is useless in Indian context. Specifically in Indian context, the payment is a useless case for Bitcoin. because we have such a brilliant payment systems developed by NPCI, like RTGS, NEFT, you have UPI, right? Instant payment. Why do you need Bitcoin? Why do you want to wait for n number of seconds or minutes to get blocked for? And anyway, there is not a trust problem here. So domestic payment is not at all a case in India. Yes, in some of the Latin American countries, they don't even have ACH, which is automated clearing houses, which do the centralized reconciliation of ledgers between different banks and all. That's how we achieve transaction settlement, right? So they don't have it. So they are looking at it from that perspective. If we can build, anyway, don't have the ACH, if we build it directly on the blockchain, how useful it would be? Yes, this could be the business cases for them. It is not for India. In terms of payments, international remittances is a good business case because of the high transaction costs. Some of the parties like Western Union and some other people are able to get down the transaction time to bare minimum, but still if there is involvement of multiple parties like correspondent banks and all that, cost is still high and time taken is also a little bit more. We might be able to solve that problem, but do we really want to solve that problem is again depending on the benefits analysis of that organization. Right? We haven't even started. So before I take you to the different types of frameworks, I just want to show you a very high-level picture of how different networks look, what are the components. These are my own representations, so just try to bear with me and try to understand what I'm saying. So this is a typical Bitcoin network. What it has different types of nodes. Some act as a full node. They have complete copy of a blockchain. They do mining also. They do validations also. They do everything. Then there are few nodes who just want to keep a copy. There are few nodes who want to do a mining. There are few nodes that come together and form a mining pool because they know that as an individual, they won't be able to survive in this mining race. So they form a mining pool. So they put together their hashing power and go as a group. And there are certain wallets which actually do not need to maintain any transaction, they don't need to validate anything, they just want their clients to do certain transactions, so they provide a UI or mobile app to them and they are used to Bitcoin transactions. That's it. So they don't need to do any other functions. So these are different types of player you would see in a typical Bitcoin blockchain network. Going next, Ethereum. So Ethereum is almost same like a Bitcoin network except for the concept of Ethereum virtual machine. So what is it? So in Bitcoin, you hash the last block, and the latest block has the hash of previous block. So you form a linked list of blocks, which we call blockchain, and then you achieve the other things. In Ethereum, instead of hashing a particular block, a complete virtual machine is hashed, and then the parties come to a consensus on the state of the complete EVM. So instead of on the achieving consensus on the hash of the latest block, you achieve consensus on the complete hash of the complete EVM. Rest are almost the same. You would also see certain things here: permission, gossip protocol. You know what is gossip protocol? When two people come together, especially ladies, what they do? They tell other what the other person doesn't know, right? Exactly. This is the gossip protocol. You are a node. You get some news. Mrs. Sharma did this. You immediately tell it to all the nodes you are connected to. So one node is not connected to each and every node in a peer-to-peer network. So you could be connected to only 10. 10 are connected to another 20. And then somehow then through some path, everybody is connected. So as soon as I get the news of Mrs. Sharma doing this, I tell it to 10 nodes, right? 10 nodes tell it to another, each 10 nodes that they know. Now somehow it also comes to me from some other node that, you know what Mrs. Sharma did? I say, yes, I know. Right? So there, we stop the sending of that particular transaction to other nodes, thereby, you know, otherwise what will happen if I keep sending everything that I know or everything I get from somebody else, the network will be flooded with the same message, right? So the protocol, what it says is, as soon as you know something, you tell all the people you know, and if you already know it, then don't tell it, right? This is a gossip protocol. This is how you spread the news in the network. Ethereum involves kind of same thing. They call it a whisper protocol. So whisper, you know. But concept is the same. You keep telling. This is how you achieve that. If there is some adversary node who doesn't want to spread a particular transaction to the network for whatever reasons, the rest of the network will ensure that it does reach everybody else. Right? And then interesting things here. You saw one of the questions on how many transactions. So if you go by that, one block in Bitcoin is maximum 1 MB. As soon as 1 MB is reached, next of a transaction go in the next block. So if you really calculate, what do you get is 7 transactions per second. Pathetic. For a financial system, 7 transactions per second is not at all a solution to any practical problems in the industry. Ethereum will try to solve it by creating a block every 15 seconds, right? 12 to 15 seconds. So what they achieve is something like 70 transactions in a block, which is 70 transactions per block per 15 seconds, which means almost 2,000 per minute. Still nowhere close to what Visa, MasterCard, and other payment systems achieve. But that's not a problem right now, because these are public blockchains, and they are not trying to solve the performance problem. They are trying to solve the trust problem. But there are others, like private, Coda. So there's an R3 consortium formed by certain banks. Now, they understood certain problems in the public network. They tried to solve it. Coda specifically tried to solve it for some financial services. What they said, the basic problem that you would hear from your client is that I don't want my data to be sent outside. I don't want it to be known to any other person than only the person that is intended to. So if I transfer something to X, only me and X should know it or have a copy of the transaction. Nobody else should have it. If you really think of that, then this is not a blockchain at all. Right? The blockchain must spread all the transactions to everybody. Then would you call it a blockchain? It doesn't matter whether you call it a blockchain or not, because that blockchain was trying to solve certain other problem. This blockchain is trying to solve a problem of privacy to their enterprise client. Does it solve the problem? Yes, it does solve the problem, because the particular transaction goes only to the person that he or she is supposed to know. And one more, centralized authority, that is the biggest problem. Now, blockchains are meant to remove the centralized authorities, but now this guy trying to solve a problem of privacy has introduced a centralized authority which is called a notary service. But it is still a popular framework. What it has generally in the network, multiple nodes that will do certain transactions. There will be a network map service which would keep a map of all the nodes that are there in the network and what kind of services they offer. It will have something like a doorman service which offers the certificate. It's a permission network. Okay? So it has to have a doorman service or identity service which provides certificates, so that every node, whenever it transmits, transaction will be validated against that certificate. It's a conventional way of validating it. There is nothing new in it. I'm not telling anything new to you, right? So it will provide that services. Notary is something that validates the transactions, if they are right or not. They also figure out, they also ensure that it is unique. And then they pass that transaction and gets spread to everybody, or not everybody, to the party that is involved. So some of the things that we talked previously is taken care of by notary here. Okay, it could be a single node or it could be multiple nodes. It could be a party. It could be a it could be a cluster of nodes coming together and forming a notary service. Simple example: if there are 10 banks coming together to do certain use case on a blockchain, and if I say he is a notary, they would say who is he? If I say I form a notary service, which would have a representation of all 10 banks, and we will have some algorithm. So if 6 out of 10 approves, then the notary would say to have approved the transaction. So banks will say, okay, fine, I am fine with that one because I have some kind of involvement in approving that transaction. So I don't want to rely on that service provider or network operator or somebody else. I want contribution into the network on the notary service also. So this is how you are solving some practical problems, right?
So that
because you have a right to say right or wrong to a transaction, right? So when you 10 people come together, I don't want that authority to be given to a single bank or some other third party. So what I say, you all 10 will vote. If 6 agrees or whatever, everybody agrees, then the transaction passes. So now you are party to that decision. You cannot shy away from, you know, I don't know what, how that transition happened, it was inherited. Now you are also party to that transaction. So you, by through this mechanism, you have built the trust in the system, in the validity of a transaction. Correct? Yeah, so it solves that problem. It will take a long time. What do you want to do? Okay, I'll try to come to some logical stop checkpoint after this one, okay?
Oh, one question, sir.
just hold on that question. Okay. I need to.
So is it fine to have, because of planned lunch break and I don't want to disturb the schedule, but if as an audience, as a delegate, all of us are fine, we can extend for another 10 more minutes. We can extend by another 10 more minutes, so if anyone not in agreement, please raise the hand. If 51% is in my favor, go ahead.
Please extend.
I think that's good. I think all of us are enjoying the session. We'll have 10 more minutes.
Okay.
And then let us continue with the session. Q&A, we will have possibility during a panel discussion. That's the only request to open. Hold on for questions. We'll get it answered for sure in a panel discussion.
And
just hold on for some time. We'll answer it.
I'm hoping that like other sessions, 51% haven't slept already. So you didn't get enough votes. Okay. So this is a typical network in Coda. Hyperledger, Hyperledger fabric. Linux Foundation started something. They say it's open source, and IBM says we don't have anything to actually do with it. But you know how much to believe. Yeah, but it is. There's one thing that you need to understand. If some protocol has to leak, it has to be backed up by a way. Specifically in the world of blockchain, there's so many frameworks. So frameworks that are not backed up by a strong entities or group of entities have a less chance of surviving. Okay. So Hyperledger, Fabric, again, tried to solve some problem in the context. They clearly said, we don't have any crypto. Our main function is to solve the problem for enterprise. So what? And enterprise also, in the enterprise, they want to solve the problem of, again, privacy. This is the main concern you would see. Everybody else who created something else is trying to solve a problem of privacy, that my data should not go somewhere else. So what they did, they created a concept of channels. So when you set up a network, you have to create a channel. So what is the channel? Channel is any use case that you want to do. So channel could be a purchase order. Channel could be a payment. Channel could be a remittance. Channel could be invoices. So you create a channel so that anybody, any party subscribe to that channel. Z Marathi gets only Z Marathi. Channel. You don't see anything else. So what that means? The the problem is solved completely? You think? Why? Why do you think problem is not solved? People doing PO are seeing PO. They are not seeing invoices. So why problem is not solved? You think problem is solved?
Yeah.
No. So I did PO with them. I sent a purchase order. You are also subscribed to the channel. You are also seeing that PO. Why do you need to see that PO? Problem is partly solved. Okay. So problem is partly solved, that now it is going only to some relevant people who have subscribed to that channel, but it is still going to the people who are actually not party to the transaction. Got it?
Yeah.
So it partially solves that. Now it also, you know, provides some other things. So if you don't want to give so much importance to this fact, there are some other things which I can provide, or rather, I call it a fabric provider, right? Which probably you in your scoring mechanism, you would decide where you want to give more weightages for what kind of factor, so that you come to conclusion, what do you want to select? So here you would see how it typically happens. A client application wants to do a transaction, so that application pushes the transaction into the network. Now every channel will have somebody, some node called endorser. Any transaction, if you want to do as an application, has to be sent to endorser. There could be n number of endorsers. And it has to send to each and every endorser. Okay? So you send transaction to each and every endorser. Endorser nodes. Endorsers are governed by the policies. For what is policy? Policy is like real life policy. My policy is it should have these, again, rules. Validation rules. So you write a policy again. Policy is a code. Property file or something. Where you read. This should be there, that should be there, that. So every endorser follows a policy. Policy is created particularly for a channel. Then you decide if it is fine or not. Endorser says, great, it looks fine. What is the output that it goes? Gives back. So here, in case of hyperledger fabric, the output is, see, in hyperledger, everything runs as a smart contract. Now, the smart contract is such a term that, you know, people get fascinated about it. Basically, smart contract is a code. You run and you get an output. As simple as that. And why it is fascinating is that people are thinking of some automated world where something happens and all the smart contracts gets executed automatically and we don't have to do anything. That kind of vision that they have probably will be reality after some years, but not today. Because of a lot of reasons, we'll touch upon that later if there is a time. So smart contract is a code that gets executed upon certain conditions getting met. That's a simple definition of a smart contract. So it is a smart contract. Every endorser get it. They run that code. They get the output. So what they give back to the application is what is called RW, the read and write data set. If I get this input, I will get that output. You give that read-write data set back to the application who requested it. All the endorsers give the same thing. Whatever their read-write is, back to the endorser. Then this, sorry, back to the application. Then application sends it to the ordering service. Now ordering service, see, currently there is only one ordering service for n number of channels in a single network. Okay, there would be different endorsers per channel. Different channels will have different endorsers. So somebody is doing purchase order, so Reliance, JSW Steel, Adani are the endorsers in that node. Somebody is doing payment, so HDFC, ICICI, SBI are the endorsers in that node, in that channel. These are two different use cases, so that endorsers are different. Endorsers are something like a notary again. Somebody who is saying this is fine. Yeah, so depending on the business case, endorsers will be different. But ordering service is the same, because ordering service, what it does? Uniqueness, right? If something has come in, it should not be sent again. So you have to order. You have to put things in order so that they get put into the blockchain and get permanently written there. So ordering service does that. So there is only one ordering service throughout the network. So this client abstains into ordering services, has the RW sets of all the endorsers same. If it is differing, then there is a problem, right? If it is same, then okay. Sounds like a valid transaction, same set to all the nodes, which are committers, right? So committer is something like node, just node. Basically, every node is a committer, and there's some of the special committers which are called endorsers, which run some additional software programs. So every committer puts it into the blockchain, and then it gets written throughout the network. That is a single channel. Here is a double channel. You can see ledger one, ledger two. Somebody is doing something on ledger one. So you can see the flow. Flow is exactly the same. Only thing is that policies will differ for two channels. Endorsers will be different. Rest of the things will be same. Right? Again, something from this ledger one will not go to the ledger two because channels. We don't want purchase order data go to the KYC data. Right? Comparing on the basic features, consensus. Also, very complicated topic in itself. There are different types of consensus algorithm. Most popular anyway you must have read is proof of work, right, which is used by the public blockchains. So proof of work, what it does, it makes it hard for the network to create a block so that every block gets created at a particular time interval, and block gets created only after spending a lot of resources. Okay? What it means is there has to be some kind of check that, you know, that requires to avoid civil kind of attack. What is civil attack? Let's say if I just go by the algorithm of voting, if 50% or more people vote, then that would be taken as a valid transaction. But if in civil attack, what happens, the attacker actually creates virtual nodes or creates a mechanism through which it appears that there are so many nodes while there is only one node, and then each of those nodes starts sending me the votings, and even if only one person or node has actually given the vote, it feels in the network that majority of the nodes have given certain output or result. Thereby, the civil attacker would be able to change the decision of a network. To avoid that, proof of work is necessary, because to create one vote, it has to spend huge amount of resources. So to give two votes, he has to spend twice the number of resources. To give 100 votes, 100 times the resources. And considering the hashing power everybody has generated, all the miners, it would be practically very difficult to actually have that multiples of hashing power. So through proof of work, what you are achieving that it comes at a particular time. You are achieving that people are spending so that there is a value in the reward that they are getting. Right? And then, end of it, because everybody knows that block has come only after doing a lot of work, there is, you know, understanding that other nodes will accept it as a valid node, or probably they will reject it based on certain conditions. And somehow, over a period of time, network will come to a conclusion on what is the current state of the network. That is how the consensus is achieved. This thing happens in Bitcoin Core and Ethereum, in Coda and Fabric, because these are private, as I said. In Coda, one peer sends a transaction to other peer. So he has to sign, the other peer has to sign. So these two have signed, then they send the signed transaction to the notary, notary has to sign. Again, notary sees that there is no double spend and all that. Notary signs it. Every transaction has actually a notary assigned to it already. So if only that notary signs, then only that is valid notarized transaction. All this works out, goes into the network. Actually, it doesn't get stored in the network, because in Coda, a ledger is not a distributed ledger. Ledger is only a transaction that I have done. So it is a subset of the whole ledger. It's like any other ledger for that matter in the banks. I can see only the transaction that I have done. Same thing happens in Coda. So ledgers are updated only with the transaction that you are considering. And in hyperledger, there is no consensus algorithm as such built in. What Fabric says that it is a plug and play and you can decide on your consensus algorithm. But there is something that is talked about more and more is a Byzantine fault tolerance. There are multiple versions of it. Practical Byzantine fault tolerance. Then there is some other fault tolerance, right? We will not get into that. Basically, what it does is it again tries to combine the votes of certain parties and see that they agree to it, and depending on n number of people agree, they say that this is that. This is roughly the algorithm, fault tolerance algorithm. It has to be, you know, you can study, there's a lot of material to read, and then you will know what is a Byzantine generous problem, which is a story, and then it has particular traits that based on that you come to the systems that nodes behaving incorrectly, intentionally or unintentionally sending out wrong signals to other machines. This is actually coming from electronics. So if incorrect output, that is voltage going to the other party, how machines come to a consensus of a particular output, that is the problem that they have solved through this algorithm. Okay, fine. So I'll just conclude now. Uniqueness, I already talked. Bitcoin, first come, first serve. Whichever gets into the blockchain first is the unique one. Ethereum has a concept of norms. So if I am sending a transaction, I have to give a norms, which is a number. So my first transaction, second transaction, third transaction. So if I send two transactions of the type of with norms, only one of those will get rejected. Most probably something that is having a minimum gas, because as a miner I want to earn maximum gas. So Ethereum runs on the gas, concept of gas, which is again ethers. So where I get maximum money, I pass that transaction, discard the other one. RT Coda has notary services so that they ensure that there is only one transaction happening. And in Hyperledger, obviously it has to go through an endorser. Validity. Most of the time, signature and the present, if it is present in the UTXO model. UTXO model is present in R3 Coda also. And in Ethereum, apart from the signature and other things, you should have enough gas mentioned in the transaction. So there is a gas limit and gas price. If you multiply that, you get how much transaction fee the miner will get if he processes that transaction. If it is less than what miner has already told. So simple concept, I as a miner say, I'll need 100 rupees or 100 X ether, whatever they call, mini ether, micro ether, I don't know. Okay, so itna hai, then only I will process. If total comes out to be less than that, it will be discarded, it's not valid. Immutability, in the first two, which is public, again it's a linked list, blocks are linked to each other, contains the hash of previous one. So over a period of time, you come to such a state that making any changes to the block that was in the past is extremely minuscule possibility of doing that. So somehow you assume that it is not going to be changed. So you achieve the immutability. Again, here concept of immutability is that particular record cannot be changed. For example, I receive X number of Bitcoins, means that record remains that way. It will not be changed, but when I transfer that, the ownership of those would be changed to other transactions. So there is another transaction that is coming in, but it is not overriding the existing data in the database, which is blockchain. So it doesn't change the owner's public key there, that it has been transferred to somebody else. A record stays as is, and that is called immutability. So you cannot change that record. But yes, you obviously can change the state of the blockchain, the current state of the blockchain, by sending another valid transaction that goes through. Right? Authentication, again, permissionless, authentication is through public and private key mechanism, and in private there are ways like in Coda, if your service is subscribed to network map service, your IP should be there, you should be doing the same type of service which has been mentioned in the network service. All these rules that are there, if all is fine, then you will be authenticated to do that transaction and transaction goes. And there are some other factors that are there, which is like scalability of nodes. Can you add more and more number of nodes? Yes, so when it is public, when it's open, scalability of nodes is very high. When it is permission, it has to go through process, so scalability is low. When it comes to the performance, obviously the performance of a public blockchain is going to be very low because of the involvement of consensus mechanism. So it has to go to everybody and they have to agree, and then it's get written to performance. Number of transaction throughput is going to be low. If you want to, if performance is your priority, public networks are not something that you should be looking at, right? So the performance can be as much as you want in the permission networks like Coda and Fabric. So you have to choose that one. Industry focus, as I said, Bitcoin is meant for payments, crypto, Ethereum says that you can do a lot of things. Fabric says that it is meant for a lot of things. Arthi Kohler clearly says this for the financial services to solve particular problems in the financial industry. And smart contract, very limited support in Bitcoin because there are set of some 256 keywords only, out of which some 75 are reserved, some are empty, and there are few things that you can use which just do very basic things. It is just called script, there is no other name to that script. It is just called script, and you can write very few things. The script has to execute end to end. And if it executes, then only it is valid. So, very limited way of achieving smart contracts in Bitcoin. So, smart contract is your prime intention. Probably other three things are more useful for you. And it allows general coding language where you have the talent pool available in Java, Go, Python. In case of Ethereum, there is Solidity. So if you have people who work on this, probably you will be able to do smart contract in there. Yeah? So if you have, you'll take it up after your stomach is full and you're still awake. And thanks for being patient and being awake.